This podcast includes graphic depictions of true crime cases and may contain explicit language. Listener discretion is advised. Hello, everyone, and welcome to We Saw the Devil. This is Robin.
This is Jackie.
And today's episode is going to be about the Affidavit of Probable Cause, as well as our thoughts on the Dateline episode. You know, there wasn't a terrible amount of new information, but it made a few light bulbs go off.
Especially Oprah. bringing to light what Oprah is really about.
Oh, man. Did any of you guys know
that about Oprah being dark?
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. That sounds kind of racist.
It does.
That's messed up, man. Oprah gives everything.
She does. Check your chair.
Check under your chair. Maybe a zombie.
We have a lot to talk about. But before we get into that, first of all, we would like to thank our executive producers. That would be Ashley M, Britni S, Christy K, Cristi R, little mini army of Christies, Faye, Ian, Iris, Kathleen, LeeAnn, Shawna, and then our newest executive producer, pardon me if I butcher your name, Ylana?
Ylana?
Ylana? Please correct me if I am wrong.
Ylana.
Thank you so much for your support, guys, as well as thank you to all of our patrons. Again, if you are not yet a patron, check us out on patreon.com/WeSawTheDevil. For as little as $5 a month, you can get a postcard of our case of the month. We'll send you a handwritten postcard, all the way up to $25. You get a t-shirt and other cool stuff. So if you like the show, you like our work, please consider supporting us.
And don't forget, they get it ad-free.
Yes, ad-free. Also, access to our afterthoughts. So after this episode, we have a Patreon-only segment where we kind of let loose. So again, please check us out on Patreon. Also, if you're not quite ready to financially back, leaving a review as well on iTunes is incredibly helpful. This is what podcasts run on, guys.
I'm not trying to make them not organic, but I'm just saying 5 stars are really nice.
They are.
I'm not trying to influence you, but 5 stars is really great. Good reviews are good.
Yeah, exactly. So please take a moment of your time, rate and review us on iTunes. We would greatly appreciate it. And beyond that, you can find us on Facebook and Twitter at We Saw the Devil, YouTube at We Saw the Devil, and then also on Instagram at We Saw the Devil Podcast. Beyond that, so in the next couple of weeks, and this has been a major request for us, is please do an introduction to this case. I know a lot of people who just got into the Lori Vallow case, just as, say, as of the 9th when the kids were found, and they don't know what the hell is going on.
It's difficult. It is very in-depth. There's a lot of minute detail that is hidden within the shadows of everything. Mm-hmm. Even reading the affidavit, you think you have the full comprehensive view, but you don't.
Not even close.
No, there's so much.
Yeah, it's admitting like the Boudreaux, the hit on Brandon Boudreaux.
Yeah.
And all of this additional information. So we're going to do an introductory series, probably a two-parter, giving you just the full overview of this case from start to finish.
I am really excited.
Yes, it should be fun. As far as what's on the horizon, we have Iris joining us next week. If you guys recall Iris from our Conversations with an Autopsy Technician episode.
I love Iris. I love her food. I love everything about her. And I think all of you should love her too.
Yeah, she got fan mail, guys. When she came on that one particular episode, we got messages on YouTube. We got messages from our website. People dropped by on Facebook, and they all want her to return. So she's coming back. And she's going to talk about the autopsy challenges, like basically with the children. So what challenges they may face, what they're looking at, how they would even approach an autopsy with remains in that condition.
Incredible information that she has to add. I love it.
Yes.
I mean, I don't love the case in that sense. I don't love that she has to talk about that, but I do love the information that she does bring to the table.
I have badgered her and I was like, Iris, I want to know the craziest thing you've ever witnessed. And so I promised her that we would discuss that as well, because I need to know. So that's all that's happening on our end. Let's discuss Dateline. So Dateline just aired and we didn't learn a whole lot.
No, it did not feel like we learned a lot. It felt like a repeat of Melanie Gibb's interview with Nate Eaton from previously.
Yeah.
It just was abbreviated, and then they tried to add in all that. They over-condensed it a little bit. I mean, I thought it was going to be 2 hours, not one.
Yeah, I thought they were... They didn't even include the Brandon Boudreaux stuff, the other shady things that have happened. I mean, it was pretty cut and dry. We had, what, all of 30 seconds of Lori's friend, April Raymond? Like, literally 30 seconds. However, she did grace us with my favorite part of the entire episode.
And what is that?
Oprah?
Why Oprah? And poor Oprah. She's done so much. Actually, I will say this. Oprah is actually a role model of mine. And I love her book club, okay? And I'm really upset. It just seems really messed up. Like, Oprah gives everything away. She does so much for charity.
And her communities. And I don't know. I laughed so hard, though, after April said that. And then they cut away. And all you hear is Keith's voice go, Oprah?
Oprah?
I laughed so hard.
Oh, man.
And I want to know how many of you, the True Crime Underground Facebook group, had a game of bingo going on tonight's Dateline.
I saw that.
Funny. So, as far as new information, there wasn't a lot of information, new information whatsoever. It just reiterated the entire story from beginning now to end with the discovery of the children. One piece, for some reason, guys, apparently my critical thinking skills, as much as I've been involved in this case and researching this case, a bomb hit me in the middle of this entire thing. You know, in thinking about the case and Melanie Gibb and just how smug and, you know, I think we all have the mindset of how did she not know? How did Melanie Gibb not know? And then it hit me watching Dateline when she last saw JJ the night of the 22nd, when Chad and Lori called her on the 26th. Just so you know, we told the cops JJ's with you. And then I'm just thinking, all of a sudden it hit me how... The holy F, did Melanie Gibb not know? That's almost 2 months to the day.
She already had her suspicions raised when Lori told her that JJ was a zombie and trying to just over-exaggerate his behavior into this narrative that she wanted to fit that JJ was a zombie. Melanie Gibb was already aware that JJ was probably in danger. I mean, logic would have it, right? Yeah. She can't be that stupid. I don't believe that. And then all this time passes, what, 2 months?
Yeah. And you mean, and 2 months, mind you, of JJ being dead. And you mean to tell me that a rambunctious, hyperactive, autistic, 7-year-old little boy who was very rambunctious and hyper by all accounts, that Melanie Gibb just, for some reason, after that visit, never talked to Lori on the phone again, never inquired about JJ, and never, you know that she no longer heard JJ.
That's the piece that really hit you.
Yeah.
Is that she no longer heard JJ and then asked her to take a fake photograph in a movie theater.
Yeah. So it's just, I was on the fence before about Melanie Gibb. And then now I'm just like, you know what? Screw you. You are complicit in this. There's no way that your red flag radar did not go off while you were in Rexburg at her house with a zombie thing. And then suddenly I know for a fact that you, I mean, it's true. She used to talk to Lori on the phone all the time. Multiple people have said that. So I know that you probably heard JJ at least over the phone at some point, knew he was present. That's 2 months without any sort of presence of JJ.
This is right before the grandparents, right? The Woodcocks reported him to the police.
Yeah.
Here's my question for you, Robin. Is if she knew, could there be charges in the future for Melanie? Could she actually be setting herself up for failure?
I mean, to be honest with you, I feel like because Melanie did end up apparently doing the right thing, I think maybe the police have offered her some sort of plea deal in order to testify against Chad and Lori to the inner workings in this and also name other people who are potentially involved.
If she is involved and it was aware, do you think she's worthy for a plea deal?
I think she belongs in jail, guys. I'm going to be completely honest here. Even if Melanie Gibb didn't participate and wasn't completely aware, she is at least guilty of extreme negligence here. I mean, can you imagine someone pretty much like openly insinuating that they're going to kill someone and you just turn a blind eye to it and you're like, I don't think that's not what they meant.
But here's the thing. Somebody had already died, right? And we can't just say, oh, it's suspicious. No. Tammy, all these people have died around these people. And now when she's talking in her interview, and anytime she's been interviewed twice now, right?
Mm-hmm.
She has openly stated, well, I knew that this was going to end up leading to a path of darkness. But then she kind of backtracks with her own language and leaves a lot of gray area in between of basically insinuating that she still believed.
Not so much in the Dateline episode as she did in the East Idaho News, I have to say. The East Idaho News, I don't think she did herself any favors on the East Idaho News interview.
But that was editing. That was an editing thing, right? Dateline was very edited. They took out a lot of stuff. And you know what bothered me? They actually left out the part about Alex coming in with JJ.
Yes.
And they didn't let David talk about that. I wanted to hear David actually talk about that because I wanted to know his take as well. But hey.
Yeah, David Warwick, so Melanie Gibb's current boyfriend, apparently, you know, he did mention that, you know, the next morning, Lori tried to pull he ran around and, you know, was jumping on the cabinetry and threw a picture or knocked a picture of Christ off of the refrigerator. And David said that he went to the cabinets and didn't see even a smudge, like there was nothing wrong. And he said, I want to see JJ. And Lori said, well, Alex took him.
You know, what's actually really interesting what Dateline did was connected the dots between the two women of Melanie Gibb and Lori Daybell by saying that they're both mothers. You mean to tell me as a mother, you're not going to be like, whoa, I would never do that to my kids. Why are you doing that to your kids?
That's what I'm not understanding in all of this, right? Is why none of these people beyond the Woodcocks. Now, by all of these people, I'm meaning Lori, Melanie Gibb, Melanie Pawlowski, Summer, Janice, literally everybody involved in this entire case. No one gave a shit about the kids. No one except for the Woodcocks. That's it.
Yeah, the Cox didn't care.
No, if Kay and Larry, bless their souls and bless their hearts, had not made that welfare check to the Rexburg police, no one would care. No one. Not a soul. The kids would just have disappeared off of the face of this earth without a care in the entire world.
Leave it to awesome grandparents to take the charge, though. I mean, seriously. You know what is kind of baffling to me is that in the interview in Dateline, Melanie Gibb states that she had called after... correct me if I'm wrong. She called Lori after she reported to the police, right?
Yes, she said that she confronted both Lori and Chad.
Why? That's kind of weird. Why didn't you just let that go at that point? I would have been like, nah, I'm good, man.
Well, I'm sure the law enforcement probably had her wired.
Well, we don't know that, though.
No.
We have no reason to believe that. So she calls to confront Lori and to say that she was confronting her adversary. Like, as if Lori's the devil now.
Yeah.
And this is after Chad came to David and said, I can't tell you where the kids are for your own safety.
Yeah, for your own safety.
Now, the question that I raise in my head is, how is Lori's refusal to work and cooperate with law enforcement going to play as an integral role in all of this? Is this going to leave her as guilty, looking more guilty, or is it not going to matter?
Like in terms of potential murder charge?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I mean, why didn't the affidavit of probable cause? I know it was related to Chad Daybell, right? Mm-hmm. But so did they not mention Lori just because Lori was at home? Were they not tracking her phone? You know they were. You know they have been. I just don't understand. Like, there was no verbiage in the affidavit at all regarding Lori or where she was or her whereabouts.
It almost sounds like, no, this is a little speculation, I will forewarn. It almost sounds like maybe all the burner phones and stuff like that has led kind of a tree.
Oh, yeah. Let's bring up the burner phones.
Oh, God.
So that is something that Melanie Gibb stated in one of her interviews, that Lori had multiple phones. And people were like, no, that's weird. That's just really weird.
Mom, you look like a drug dealer.
Yeah, so both April Raymond and Melanie Gibb have now said that she had multiple, quote, burner phones to talk to people in the group. Now, why would she need multiple phones?
Now, I want to bring this up right now, is that in the interview in Dateline with Melanie Gibb, when she's speaking, something she said something that kind of caught my ear, where she almost said group. Mm-hmm. And she literally said that Lori had moved to fulfill her, like, you know, to try and carry on the mission. But as she was speaking, she stumbled and she almost said to be a part of the group.
And I, for some reason, I was writing a note down and I somehow missed that. And so I said, what did she say? She was moving to Idaho to be with a group. And my brain even as well completed that sentence, because that's just how, that's what she was about to say.
Well, you were taking notes. So your brain was, you know, trying to split and you're just hearing what you're hearing. And then you're writing at the same time. So literally you registered what she didn't say, what she was going to say.
Yeah.
And that is interesting to me.
Well, and Melanie Gibb did say she was using her burner phones to talk to the group. So group. Now we have multiple people. Mm-hmm. A group is more than one. You know, she needed those burner phones for more people.
It just, you know, what's interesting to me is that everything is kind of following this narrative of Chad and Lori trying to fulfill their destiny together.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we know that based on their weird beliefs and everything else. But the story is telling the tale of, okay, so the storage unit happens, you know, the shots are fired from the Jeep, and then all of a sudden they're buying wedding rings.
Mm-hmm.
Same kind of thing, right? So Charles, same thing with Charles. She's just like, well, I got, you know, I was told, the Lord told me that I need to tie up his finances.
Oh, that is something that I hadn't heard before. I knew that she attempted to gain access to Charles's life insurance policy. And it seems as though, remember, she changed the password on his account and he had to go through all of the paperwork. Justin Lum actually released the emails between Charles and his insurance company. So it was crazy to hear that Lori had told Melanie Gibb that she, you know, because Lori had painted Charles out to be this terrible, abusive, evil person. And then Melanie on Dateline was like, well, I was really surprised, you know, that she would go all the way back to Texas to be with Charles. And she said, the Lord told me that I needed to tie up his finances.
God bless.
God bless. Just, Jesus.
What's interesting is that don't forget that this is Lori is the same woman who is laughing while talking to police while Charles had just died on her living room floor.
Yep.
I mean, she just served herself some sweet, sweet paycheck. So she thought.
But alas, it did in fact go to Kay. And then everyone knows that Lori sent Kay the nasty, you know, text message. However, I feel like Lori has a lot more wherewithal and cognitive, you know, decision-making skills than I previously thought.
Well, she's not Jeffrey Dahmer, right? She's not or Ted Bundy. She's not charming. Or is she? Melanie Gibb does state that Lori is kind of a charmer.
She says she has a personality like Velcro.
She's kind of a recruiter.
Did you have any other thoughts, Jaci, on Dateline?
I just think it's kind of messed up what Chad said about Tammy being like, oh, she would understand dying.
Yeah.
I don't think so. Sorry. I wouldn't understand dying.
Right?
Robin, you can't kill me.
I wouldn't understand. That was heartbreaking.
Yeah,
I agree. What a piece of filth. Like, literally everybody in this entire case, pretty much, minus probably, say, the Woodcocks, Zach Cox, probably Adam, I would assume. He's, you know, stayed out of this. And that's basically it.
It makes me angry, to be honest. It really makes me angry because I feel like all these people around the kids and nobody but the grandparents
cared
enough to call the police and be like, hey, their parents are kind of messed up and they're talking about how people are zombies and now people have died.
Yep.
And now they're talking about the kids being zombies. How come at no point Melanie Gibb talked to anybody else about this?
Yeah.
That's weird. I would be like, hey, so my friend's losing it. I'd be like, so I'm not sure what to do. My friend just said that her son's turning into a zombie and that her daughter just turned into a zombie and is missing in my mind. I haven't seen her. And she's saying she's at BYU. I mean,
and Melanie even admitted that Lori telling her that Tylee was at BYU made no sense whatsoever.
Right. But there was never, it doesn't sound like she made an argument for the kids at any point.
No.
Until it was too late.
And Melanie Gibb is a mother. She has, what, 4 children of her own? But she surely didn't care about her best friend's children.
And that goes back to my point earlier about how she's a mother, but yet has zero motherly instinct. Please.
I don't get it. Everyone in this case is a complete piece of crap. So I don't know. My main takeaway from the Dateline episode as a whole is that I think Melanie Gibb is 100% complicit. And I don't think that her going on East Idaho News, Dateline, and whatever other interview she's going to do and, you know, sit there and smugly or maybe nervously, whatever reason, smile and be like, yeah, it was so weird. And I just had, you know, darkness and adversary and la, 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 la. Sorry, lady, you knew.
She knew the list. Why didn't she bring forward that she felt like Oprah shouldn't be on that list? That's important too, okay? I love Oprah. Screw you, Lori.
So, anything else, Jaci?
I think I'm angry enough. I think I'm done being angry for a moment.
Take a deep breath. Take a deep breath, everyone.
And get a glass of wine.
Yeah. Alrighty, so the affidavit. Page 1 is obviously just the cover page of the affidavit, and so the text actually starts out on page 2. This is the probable cause affidavit of Detective Ron Ball, and it starts out by stating that the Rexburg Police Department has been involved in the search of the children since November 26th, 2019, and it goes over Lori's current charges and legal situation. As everyone knows, Lori's in jail currently. It actually specifically notes that Chad was in Kauai with Lori at the time of the arrest and then also came to her court appearance on March 6th. And I know all of you remember Chad sitting there on the row in the court, just like smiling and looking like a smug Mr. Potato Head. It goes on to confirm that the last verifiable sighting of Tylee Ryan was on September 8th, 2019 in Yellowstone National Park. The last verifiable sighting of JJ Vallow was on September 22nd, 2019, in his mother's apartment. Moving on to page 3. So, Lori moved to Rexburg on or about September 1st to townhouse number 175. Alex moved in with Lori, but then eventually moved into his own apartment, number 107. And Jaci and Amanda went to Rexburg, and they went to the townhouse complex and saw their homes.
Yes, and also saw the camera where the video was obtained, where JJ was last recorded and seen.
Mm-hmm.
Like, truly seen by the neighbors, anyway.
Mm-hmm. Here, to me, in all of this, is the most interesting date. And that date is September 19th. So, Melanie Gibb visited Lori from September 19th through the morning of September 23rd. Now, that was the last time that JJ was seen. And if you recall, right, remember the nanny? Lori hired a nanny slash babysitter to come babysit JJ on the 19th because Lori likely went to go pick up Melanie Gibb from the airport. The nanny talks about how Lori, her friend, which was Melanie, and Alex all come back that night of the 19th. And the nanny saw both of them. The nanny was there with JJ. So the nanny was taking care of JJ. So we have on the 19th confirmed Melanie Gibb, Lori, Alex, and JJ. Now, when Melanie Gibb arrived, Lori told Melanie that JJ was a zombie. Remember her interview with East Idaho News of her saying that Lori said he was a zombie and I was looking at him, trying to figure it out?
It's kind of messed up because she knew what that meant.
Mm-hmm.
She knew, and all the core values in which Chad's been preaching, Lori's been talking about what it meant to be a zombie. And she seemed really complicit in it.
Mm-hmm. There'll be more on that later. We will talk about Melanie Gibb. Melanie also admitted to Ron Ball that she heard Lori call Tylee a zombie in the spring of 2019. Lori asked Tylee to babysit JJ, and Tylee apparently didn't want to. So Lori called her a zombie, and Tylee replied, "Not me, Mom." And when I read that, I wanted to cry.
My heart dropped.
Dropped.
I can't handle it.
So what that means is that Tylee was aware of Chad's doctrine, first of all, his belief system. Tylee knew what would happen to zombies, it sounds like. Not me, Mom. Just like, it killed me. Dagger through the heart. Moving on to page 4, Lori had said and told Melanie Gibb that Tylee had become a zombie when she was 12 or 13 years old, as that's when she became, quote, difficult to deal with. And it's kind of like, no joke, Tylee's, you know, biological father died. Like, Tylee has seen just horrendous things throughout her entire life.
And being
a teenager,
being taught this insane idea that people can become zombies and unclaimed spirits can possess them.
Yeah.
Okay. That's not even normal Mormon doctrine.
No.
That goes way above and beyond and outside of the realm of what a teenager should have to deal with. And yeah. I feel so bad for her.
Mm-hmm.
That's terrible.
And 12 or 13 years old. I don't know about any of you, but I was a hellion at that age.
Well, I don't think you still. Well, you still are. So I still am. But I think that I've never met a teenage girl who isn't going through some stuff.
Yeah. Especially with one with as traumatic of a background as Tylee has. So I don't know, you know, and then thinking about how, you know, it sounds like Lori was guilty of neglect in every aspect throughout their lives. So Tylee, after Charles and Lori adopted JJ, you know, it sounds like Tylee became a massive caretaker to JJ. So apparently, according to Lori, Lori called her a zombie back in the spring of 2019.
How ridiculous. I've never met a teenage girl who's been like, I don't want to babysit my brother.
Who hasn't said
I'm
that?
I'm sorry. It's just sad. It's just terrible. Lori's a monster.
Mm-hmm. So on January 26th of 2020, a search warrant was served on Chad Daybell and Lori Vallow in Kauai. And we all, this is actually when we picked up the case and it got on our radar. On September 23rd, 2019, JJ had an unexcused absence. On September 24th, the next day, Lori Vallow called Vicki Barton of the Madison School District and informed her that JJ was going to Louisiana with his grandparents and wouldn't be home until the end of October, maybe later. So on October 29th, the Madison School District was informed that JJ would be homeschooled. And during the future searches of Lori's apartment in Rexburg, no evidence of homeschooling material was ever found. He was not homeschooled, I think, as we all knew.
Mm-hmm.
So it goes on to mention the last verifiable sighting of Tylee Ryan was in Yellowstone National Park on September 8th, 2019. And photographs establish that she was there with Lori, JJ, and Uncle Alex. And they drove there in Alex's silver Ford F-150 pickup, which some people and web sleuths and whatnot have potentially or possibly taken photographs of Alex's Ford F-150. Now, this trip, and this is what's interesting, this trip was further established by tracking the GPS, cell tower connections, and Google account information on Alex Cox's phone. And this is the piece that blew me away. So page 5 goes on to talk about CAST, and that stands for the Cellular Analysis Survey Team. And that's an FBI unit that provides analyses of cell phone records and presents the information to law enforcement. So Rexburg, you know, when the FBI got involved, CAST was a huge unit that was involved in this and trying to decipher cell phone records and GPS pings. CAST uses, they say, cellular devices, GPS data points, cell tower connections, Wi-Fi connections, and Google tracking information to establish the location of cell phones. The GPS data points used by CAST are considered to be highly accurate and can place the device within a 6-meter radius, which is insane.
That's very accurate.
Yeah.
That's actually very accurate of a pinpoint, especially when you have so much land to cover an area. Mm-hmm. Don't forget that you have a lot of variables that are also included in that. It's just like when you set up your home Wi-Fi, you have to worry about your walls and what they're made of. Sometimes you don't get a good Wi-Fi connection.
Mm-hmm. 6-meter radius. That is pretty precise. So how long is 6 meters? That's about 19.685 feet, so almost 20 feet, or about as tall as a giraffe.
Yeah, that's pretty accurate.
So when the FBI, when CAST, starts analyzing Alex Cox's, which we're about to go over that timeline, his records, they're pinpointing him to about a 20-foot area, which is pretty amazing.
And that's breakthrough. That's groundbreaking.
Mm-hmm.
That is a great use of technology for the FBI. And I applaud them for their efforts in that.
Yes. So let's talk about the timeline of the trip to Yellowstone, because this took place on September 8th. And this is one of the biggest pieces of speculation in all of these groups is what happened at Yellowstone. Was Tylee murdered there? Because I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Jaci, but we all initially thought that the kids were buried in Yellowstone.
Yeah. And we talked about the death zone.
Yeah, we did. We talked about the death zone and everything else. Okay. So on September 8th, Alex Cox's phone exited the west entrance of Yellowstone National Park at 6:40 p.m. And that's in Montana, I learned.
Yes, it is.
I didn't know that Idaho doesn't have an entrance to Yellowstone.
Mm-mm, it starts in Montana.
Didn't know that.
Yellowstone mostly encompasses Wyoming, Montana, and there's a little slither in Idaho, but the entrance, there's the west, the north, and I think the south entrance.
You would think that if there's some Yellowstone in Idaho, there'd be an entrance in Idaho. However, there is not, and that is something that I've learned. I've been to most big national parks, but I have not been to Yellowstone yet. So, the more you know. So, it exited the park at 6:40 p.m., and his phone appeared to be at Buckaroo's Barbecue Grill in West Yellowstone, Montana, from 6:45 to 7:02. So, 17 minutes, it was inside of a restaurant. The phone then returns to Rexburg at approximately 8:37 at night, so about an hour and a half, which is accurate for the drive. And the phone is then at Lori's apartment until 9:35 that evening. Looks like Alex was at Lori's apartment. And then he goes to Maverick on Main Street in Rexburg at 9:43 and only stays for 10 minutes. He then goes back to Lori's apartment and he's there from 10:44 to 11:15 at night.
Where was he from 9:53 to 10:44?
Good question. That's a long time. That's almost a whole hour. Where was Alex for that whole hour?
That's unaccounted for, and does he even have an alibi?
Right. They left that out. So I'm just curious where he was for that full hour.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting.
And then at 11:44 at night, he's located at his residence at apartment 107. So again, another hour of discrepancy there. Where was he during that time?
I have no idea. That's crazy.
So let's start. But here's where it gets interesting. They're out at Yellowstone that day. They come home. Alex makes a couple trips, restaurant, Lori's apartment. He goes back to his apartment. On Monday, that night, September 9th, at midnight, his phone was located at his apartment. At 2:42 a.m., he is back at Lori's apartment. He's at Lori's apartment from 2:42 in the morning to 3:37 in the morning. So he's in the middle of the night. He suddenly gets up and goes to Lori's apartment. And the document, the affidavit, says this is significant, not only because he is there in the middle of the night, but also because this is the only time in September he appears to go over to Lori's between midnight and a.m.
Why do you think they found that significant?
Well, it's kind of random, you know, to go over to someone's house at 2 in the morning. Like 2-3 in the morning.
It's odd.
It is odd. At 4:37 a.m., Alex goes back to his apartment and he stays there until 8:59 a.m. So he goes to Lori's, stays for almost an hour, and then he goes home for almost 4 hours. At 9:21, he is pinged and located on Chad Daybell's property.
Now that is weird.
That is very weird. And the 921 reading is GPS data point, and it places him behind the house near the east end of the barn. That is very, 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 very specific. Now, Tylee and the trip to Yellowstone was the day before. They leave, come home later that evening. Alex goes to and from a couple places that night, but first thing in the morning, he's located at Chad's property. And moving on to page 6, Alex's phone was still at the Daybell residence as of 10:39. At 10:47, his phone shows a hit at the city of St. Anthony. Now, St. Anthony is only about a 5-minute drive from the Daybell residence, so it is possible that his phone just pinged a cell phone tower, so he could have actually still been at the residence and not left.
I heard that it's very common that you mm-hmm. get a false ping at a tower sometimes.
Exactly. So that is a possibility. Between 10:57 in the morning and 11:39, Alex is solely at the Daybell property. So here are two possible scenarios. Alex was at Chad's house from 9:21 to 11:39, so for like, you know, almost like a little over 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
Or Alex went to Chad's property, left to go somewhere down the street, and came back. If he did leave and come back, where did he go? We don't know. but
we may not know.
Exactly. Okay, so from 11:52 to 12:02, he went to Del Taco in Rexburg, and then he went home and spent pretty much the rest of the day in his apartment. But he was at Chad's property for over 2 hours. Another interesting part is just a matter of minutes, 14 minutes after Alex's last ping on the property, Chad Daybell sends Tammy, his wife, a text message. So Chad texts Tammy at 11:53 a.m. and says, "Well, I've had an interesting morning. I felt I should burn all of the limb debris by the fire pit before it got too soaked by the coming storms. While I did so, I spotted a big raccoon along the fence. I hurried and got my gun, and he was still walking along. I got close enough that one shot did the trick. He is now in our pet cemetery. Fun times." Chad then texts her again 3 minutes later and says, "Gonna shower now and then write for a while at BYU. Love you." Tammy replies to Chad hours later at 2:47 and says, "Good for you." Chad replies to Tammy a minute later and says, "I'm back home now." And this is what our source, if you're in our Patreon group, this is what one of our sources confirmed to us weeks ago, was that there was a text message about a raccoon. And that was a piece of the probable cause for the search warrant.
And it's highly suspicious because raccoons are nocturnal.
Mm-hmm. So also with that, neighbors reported seeing lots of bonfires at Chad's property. And that was completely out of character for them. Now, they'd lived there for a couple of years and no bonfires. And suddenly, lots of bonfires, especially after Tammy's death. So a detective from the Fremont County Sheriff's Office spoke to Samantha Williams, Tammy's sister, and she ended up confirming that both she and Tammy were huge animal lovers, and they had a pet cemetery behind the house on the property. And again, that text message was sent 14 minutes after Alex's last ping on that property. And spoiler alert, the location of the pet cemetery is the exact same place where Alex's phone pinged on the property.
Do you think that more information is going to come out about Tammy now?
Yeah, well, when Tammy's autopsy comes out, yes.
How they kind of stated it in the affidavit, I find it to be relevant because it seems that there could be more evidence that's going to come out about Tammy's death.
You know, honestly, I wonder with the bonfires if they were burning evidence too.
That's what I'm wondering. That's what I'm wondering. Anyway.
So, page 8. So on June 3rd, Ron Bald interviewed Melanie Gibb and David Warwick, her boyfriend. And this is where Melanie described how Lori called JJ a zombie and pointed out behaviors like sitting still and watching TV, claiming JJ said he loved Satan, and an increase of vocabulary. And Lori made all of that seem like evidence to, you know, tell Melanie why JJ was now a zombie. It says that Gibb observed JJ's behavior and felt it to be the same as she had always observed it. I'm just like,
she's acting like JJ was suddenly possessed.
Yes. Furthermore, so Melanie and David last saw JJ the night of the 22nd. Alex, so apparently my understanding is that Lori, Melanie, and David wanted to record a podcast. So Alex took JJ to enable them to do that without distraction. So Alex comes back later that night, and JJ appears to be asleep on his shoulder. He's out cold. And David Warwick remarked that he noticed that specifically because it seemed to be a tender moment between Alex and JJ. That was late at night. The next morning, Melanie Gibb and David, they woke up between 8 and 9 a.m., and they go downstairs, and JJ's gone. And Lori told them that JJ had been acting like a zombie and had been crawling on the kitchen cabinetry and had gotten on top of the cabinetry and the space between the cabinets and the ceiling, and also knocked a picture of Jesus off the refrigerator. And Lori informed them that Alex had come and taken JJ.
Now, doesn't this kind of bring to light the fact that they did do a search of the extra crawl space?
Yeah.
I feel like that kind of connects the dots on that.
Somehow. Something had to have been important for them to come back with new homeowners living there so long.
I get such an eerie feeling when I read about Alex holding JJ.
I know.
It's hard not to. And it scares me. Honestly, it scares me to think that somebody could be so sinister
I mean, I don't know. We will talk about that, though. But
all of it's crazy.
I feel, yeah, all of it is absolutely insane. But that was really sad. I think everyone who read the affidavit originally, when it dropped, when they got to that part, they're like, JJ was dead. But we don't know that, guys. That is speculation.
That is speculation.
So we've already covered the timeline of, you know, of Ty Lee's disappearance. Now let's talk about the timeline of the 23rd of when JJ was last seen. So that was on September 23rd, the day that Melanie and David woke up, talked to Lori, and Lori said he's gone. Alex took him. So Alex is a busy man again. At 9:55 that morning, Alex is again on Chad Daybell's property. He was there until about 10:12 in the morning. So, God, like what, 20 minutes?
That's not very long.
Not long at all. The pings on his phone locate Alex near the pond on Chad's property at the northern edge near a tree. Oh. And if you look, Annie Cushing actually posted it in True Crime Underground, but she took the aerial view of Chad's property and actually marked where the children were found, along with the tree, the fire pit, the pond, and so forth.
I find that to be very a very helpful visual as to tying everything together.
Mm-hmm. It is. I think people think that the back of Chad's property is just huge and vast, but it actually wasn't that big.
No.
But it does show you how far Ty Lee and JJ were buried away from each other. They weren't really that close to each other.
I believe that to be purposeful, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. Moving on to pages 9 and 10, I'm going to condense these together. So the FBI CAST unit analyzed Alex's movements on Chad's property. Remember, they can get right down to like within 6 meters. There were a handful of trips, with the longest being on September 9th, the day after Ty Lee was last seen. He was there for 2.5 hours that day. On June 9th, a search warrant was executed at Chad's property and multiple sites of interest were found, corresponding with Alex Cox's cell pings. So there are two sites that they discuss in the affidavit. In site one is on the north side of the pond near the north edge of the property. This site corresponded with two GPS pings from Alex Cox's phone on September 23rd, 2019. A patch of the ground was located that appeared to be disturbed. The weed growth on the top of the disturbed ground was shorter than the surrounding weed growth.
That's a pretty obvious.
Yeah.
Telltale that something was probably disturbed.
Yeah. And that, I mean, just visual identification of grass growth has been around for quite a while.
Yeah, exactly.
So members of the FBI ERT team removed the top layer of sod, and underneath there were several large flat rocks. The rocks were removed and two pieces of flat paneling were found. The paneling was removed and investigators exposed a round object covered in black plastic. And they noted that they immediately detected an odor. What they did is they made several incisions, very light incisions, through the top of the plastic. And it exposed what appeared to be a body wrapped in black plastic. So they again made incisions through the black plastic, and then they found white plastic. So then they cut through the top of the white plastic, and they observed what appeared to be the top crown of a head with light brown hair.
Oh, that's sick.
It's so sad. And if you look at, again, Annie Cushing, the aerial view, JJ was at the very, 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 very back of the property. Like, if you're looking at the house directly in front of it, he was at the very, very, very far back near the tree. And that is just so horrifically sad. The remains were confirmed immediately by a forensic anthropologist on the scene to be human in nature. The second site was located behind a red unattached outbuilding, located roughly in the center of the property near the fire pit. Now, you can easily see this outbuilding. It's a very large red barn looking thing. Next to the fire pit is an area used as a pet cemetery. And that site matched the pings to Alex Cox's cell phone. After putting in, what they did was they took steel rods and they put it into the ground to determine disturbances in the soil under the surface. They found a suspicious area. They found dog and cat remains, but then they brought in a backhoe for further excavation. Remember Chad's text message to Tammy?
Yes.
Buried a raccoon. So they discovered two bones initially, but the forensic anthropologist can determine if they were animal or human. Upon further digging, they found other bones, charred tissue, and charred bones. The forensic anthropologist designated them to be non-adult human remains. Grizzly However, if you look at the aerial overview photo, you can see some of the remains that one of the photographers is taking a picture of at that dig site, at Tylee's dig site.
I don't understand why they didn't tarp it.
I do not understand that.
I don't think the public needed to see that.
No. They don't need that getting
aired out in public.
Yeah.
I mean, what people don't realize is that it's a branch of many people who, the living are the ones who are the victims of the victims.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened, the tragedy that happened to them. And it's so sad. And when people see things like that, their family members are impacted and being like, oh, wow, great.
Yeah, it's just so incredibly sad, you know? So like, I feel like they should have secured the site a little bit more than they did. Yeah. It's terrible. So page 11. As this was occurring, Chad Daybell was sitting in his car in his driveway. He then moved across the street to Emma and Joseph, his daughter and son-in-law's house. She lived across the street. He was sitting in his car, and when he saw them start digging up the remains at the sites, he took off, and he drove away. Officers immediately pursued him, conducted a traffic stop, and took him into custody.
They noticed that he was being suspicious and watching where their movements were on the property from across the street at his daughter's house, too.
Yeah, exactly. And then as soon as they got in, I think it was Tylee that they discovered,
Yeah. He
took off.
Of course.
Where was he going? His lawyer claims that he was going to turn himself in. If that were the case, he would have pled guilty.
But of course, we had to plead not guilty because that's what terrible people do.
You suck a filth.
He can't even take responsibility because he's so vile.
Mm-hmm. That is the affidavit, guys. Another document that was aired today is Chad waived his right to a timely preliminary hearing. And basically all that means, that's very, very common. That just basically means that it gives both sides, the defense and the prosecution, additional time to prepare for it. So no big, huge deal there. Just wanted to, you know, glance over it. That was the only new legal document item this week.
Do you think they're going to do another discovery with the new findings?
I don't know. At this point, I can't even speculate on the legal side of things. I'm just waiting for more evidence and more things to come out.
The next wave will be coming soon.
Yes.
Absolutely.
All right. So that is the affidavit. Now, I feel, correct me if I'm wrong, Jaci, that this actually opens up more questions than it solves.
And we did mention that earlier, and I feel that to be correct.
Okay. I have some questions. So the very first one is, everyone knows that Chad left Rexburg on September 19th and was seen on a plane heading to Mesa. He was seen on a plane. And now, don't forget that Melanie Gibb arrived. He left the same day that Melanie Gibb arrived. Why did he go to Mesa?
Good question.
A little bit of like timestamp on this. So Lori had been in Rexburg for 19 days if she moved there, say, on September 1st. Alex originally moved in with her, but then in unit 175, but then eventually moved to his own apartment, number 107. And he had the largest of the townhomes. Alex had the largest. By the 19th, it's likely that Tylee had been dead and buried basically in Chad's backyard for about 10 days. So Chad up and leaves and gets on a plane to go to from Idaho Falls is where he flies out of, and he flies into Mesa, Arizona. And the woman sitting beside him, she, you know, after all of this went viral and whatnot, she was like, I sat by him. And she claims that Chad said that he was going to Mesa, like a relative in the valley who needed to remodel her home. And he said, quote, I hope we can get this work done in the time that I have before I have to be back. Now, don't forget that during this time, for that Friday, Lori went to the airport to pick up Melanie Gibb and had a babysitter come take care of JJ. Remember the babysitter interview?
Yes.
So Lori returns with Melanie Gibb and Alex Cox. Why did Chad actually go to Mesa, Arizona? There is no way that he went to Arizona to help with a house.
Why do you believe that he didn't go there to help with the house?
I mean, who would? Who would literally fly multiple states away to assist in, you know, home renovations? And to my knowledge, Chad didn't really have any family in the valley.
I can't even get friends to watch a dog.
Right?
$300, $400.
Yeah, I don't understand it personally at all. So that brings us back to Jason Mao. He is name dropped by Melanie Gibb in the police station interview with her, Lori, and Tylee. And she's like, oh, yeah, we just passed Jason, our cop buddy friend, Jason Mao. They are clearly, clearly connected. Now, a few things about Jason Mao.
So this guy thinks he is a god and that he was a U.S. Army paratrooper, military police guy who ended up being a cop for Chandler PD and Phoenix PD.
Yes, he was, as Jaci said, a paratrooper, government contractor. He claims that he was a SWAT team leader. It has been confirmed that he was also a narcotics detective.
Interesting, right?
Mm-hmm. And he has basically multiple connections to law enforcement in different agencies. Like, that is factual. Jason Mao worked for the Chandler Police Department, and then he resigned in August of 2006, right before an internal affairs investigation was being conducted. So basically, it was him and another officer. And the other officer, I believe his name was Dixon, performed a traffic stop on a woman and apparently basically tried to pressure her into going on a date with him. So he ends up getting fired and let go. And then there's an internal affairs investigation being conducted. Jason Mao actually ended up resigning basically due to bad performance. And then his superior officers and boss said that he had, quote, sloppy reports. So from there, he ended up going to the Phoenix Police Department, where he worked for 11 years until July of 2017. And then he went on disability retirement for an accidental disability. For some reason, I don't know, he has an actual lawsuit currently against the city of Phoenix. Okay, fine. Who is this random man that was, you know, a police officer and in the military?
Too bad he didn't go on disability because of his brain injury.
Right. So he is currently a doomsday, a Mormon, you know, LDS doomsday author. He has a series of novels called The War Chapters. And ding, 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 they are actually published by Chad Daybell's publishing company. Imagine that.
Wow. They don't know each other, though. Yeah.
And Jason Mao worked with Chad, Lori, and Melanie Gibb on Preparing a People podcast up until December of 2019. And this is all confirmed via Facebook and photo albums. He also has other ties to Preparing a People, as well as a vow. He has taught at Rexburg at BYU, the Rexburg campus. He did that in fall semester of 2019. As everyone knows, it's said that Jason is actually the one responsible for introducing Lori and Chad, setting them up as well as sealing them. So it's actually speculated and, you know, thought about that Jason is the one that actually sealed them in a temple ritual. The funny part of all of this is that I did a little digging into Jason Mao. Now, also on Lori Vallow's discovery, you know, she's in jail. Her defense attorney, obviously, in the phase of discovery, had a list of witnesses. And Jason Mao is listed as one of them.
How quaint.
How quaint. So my favorite part of all of this is that Jason Mao is very, very active on Facebook. And I did find a post from June 10th. So what, 11 days ago. And he posted a picture of basically... I just see a screenshot. He's terrible at cropping. But it's of military people, it looks like, you know, about to execute everyday citizens. And he said, hey, everybody, relax. The very first thing every socialist revolutionary party does when they take power is line up all the politicians against a wall and shoot them. Maybe we should just let this play out a little longer. Wait for it. No. But... interesting part of this is that someone on his friends list said, her name is Amy Moore, said, I guess you associating with cult-like people who allegedly kill their spouses and kids is okay as well. Burn. So Jason replies, wow, good morning, troll. Fake news. They have never been my friends, and if they did kill their kids, I hope they burn in hell. Stop believing conjecture, unnamed source, and outright lies. If you think I was involved and you have proof, then call the FBI. 1-800-CALL-FBI is their national hotline.
I'm glad he has one phone number memorized. That's cute.
Yeah.
Just hearing him, you can just hear how narrow-minded he is, the kind of person... and his personality just shining through. Ugh.
Yeah.
It makes my skin crawl.
And so a woman named Andrea replies and said, I just stumbled across this. So there has been some speculation as to who is involved in their religious group of friends. The friends that may or may not think zombies can possess people. I think some people may assume you are friends because you had a podcast with Lori Vallow Daybell that Chad Daybell spoke on. And Jason Mao replied, how does that make me a friend? Did you tear into David Letterman because he had Bill Cosby on his show? Or complain to NBC when they interviewed Clinton after he lied about having sex in the White House? Nonsense. I had lots of different guests on my show, and my professional acquaintance with Lori and Chad ended long ago before anyone knew they were wacko. I don't follow them or believe any of their nonsense.
Oh, I'm glad to know that he thinks he's David Letterman.
Right?
And that he's had so many prestigious guests on his podcast.
Such a narcissist.
Yeah.
And Andrea, the woman who's leaving the comments, she's not rude. Amy was the one who left the, you know, you're friends with people who killed their kids. Andrea follows up and is just like, hey, you know, question. And he gets so defensive, aggressively defensive. Now, here's the thing, Mr. Mao, is that Lori Vallow called you as a witness in her discovery. And you have a history going back to them for a very long time. I mean, their podcast, right when this started, their podcasts were available. So Jason Mao, and a couple of them actually are still available on YouTube. You can find the podcast with Lori, Chad, Jason, and Melanie. And so these continued for a bit. He also worked out of Rexburg as a professor. And it's just asinine to think that he is not, you know, in the very least connected to Lori and Chad in some way.
The fact that they even try to name drop him is pretty telltale.
Yeah, Melanie Gibb just name drops him right there. Our friend, Jason Mao. So you mean to tell me that, but you weren't a friend, right?
What about Chad? Chad and Jason Mao. Didn't he need some sort of saw?
Yes. So good point. Okay, so on September 2nd, Jason Mao has this post on Facebook. Hey, Facebook family. Anyone in the East Valley have an electric miter saw I can borrow? Putting in new baseboards, and we ran into a slight problem.
Okay, that's not little telltale heart, right?
It's a little weird, isn't it? If that's not weird enough, so also on... Now, okay, let's start with the miter saw. That was on September 2nd. September 19th, 17 days later, Chad ends up flying to Mesa, Arizona to help someone that he claims is renovating their house. Coincidence? I think not.
You know how far away Arizona is from Idaho? I mean, we can just imagine that, right? We know the map of the United States.
It is a 13 and a half hour drive.
Yeah.
Just so you know, because I will be talking about that momentarily. 13 and a half hour drive. So why would Chad go down to Arizona to Mesa? And here's the kicker. Looking up flight records, we see the flight from Idaho Falls. Now, Chad flies out of Idaho Falls as Melanie Gibb flies into it.
Weird.
So Chad flies to Mesa. A woman spots him. He's confirmed, you know, on the plane in the airport by multiple people, actually, at this point. And he's in Arizona. Where does he go? Does he have a car? Did he rent a car? Who picked him up? What was he doing in Arizona? And why was he gone the weekend that JJ died? Or was he? How did he make it home? You know why we don't know? Is because there were no flights back to Mesa, Arizona.
Of course.
I'm sorry.
Back to Idaho.
There were no flights back to Idaho. And that's from Allegiant or any other airline. There's no way Chad would have made it back flying.
Of course. Of course, it has to be even more weird and twisted than we thought before.
Just interesting thing there. I do not understand.
It seems peculiar and a little bit suspicious, don't you think? I struggle getting a friend to come watch my dogs.
Yeah.
All right? And even if they live across the street, like, people don't want to take on that kind of responsibility. I don't know anyone nice enough to be like, I'm going to do X, Y, and Z and go and pay $300 for a flight just to fix your house, to renovate your house. I'm sure you have other friends. I mean, this guy is supposed to be so, like, well-known and have such a good base of helpful people who follow him. You'd think that he'd know somebody from law enforcement or whatever who knows how to renovate a home.
Something.
Yeah. It just seems overreaching.
Do any of you have information as far as what Chad was doing there, who he was talking to, how he made his way home, or even around Arizona? Because it makes absolutely no sense. So there's that. Now, also my last piece on Jason Mal, and we are going to be going down a Jason Mal rabbit hole here, because I truly believe that there is something far more to him and his involvement in all of this.
I agree.
Now, another interesting piece is that on July 12th of 2019, now that is July 12th, and that is the day after Charles Vallow was shot and killed. Remember, Charles was killed on July 11th.
Yes.
Jason Mal posts, looking to buy a used Jeep four-door Wrangler. Anyone know a guy?
Did they ever find that guy?
Well, Brandon Boudreau, if you recall, Melanie Pawlowski's ex-husband, was shot at by someone in a four-door Jeep. Apparently, you know, Brandon Boudreau and everyone thinks that it was Tylee's Jeep that was registered to Charles. Could have been likely. This is probably a nasty coincidence. But literally the day after Charles was shot, it's like, is Jason Mal just rubbing it in?
Do you think he's a mad prepper?
Yeah, I believe he is. Is Jason Mal rubbing it in knowing that Charles had just been killed? Like, I feel like Jason Mal was involved.
It feels like he could be a head kind of like leader of all of this.
Yep.
It's starting to really feel that way. And I don't know why more about him hasn't come out. Maybe perhaps the FBI is investigating and it just hasn't come forward yet.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. I believe that more people are going to tumble out of this.
I agree with that. He has a sinister aura about him. And I'm not trying to like over speculate, you know, because everything is based on facts. It's a fact that it's odd that we have this like disconnect between them, saying one minute they know him, next minute they don't. Next minute they know him, next minute they don't.
Yep.
That to me is suspicious.
It really is. I want to know what happened and how Chad got home, because this affidavit in the timeline, right? All we know is Alex Cox's movements from this document. I have no doubt in my mind that law enforcement and investigators know everything.
Okay, so Alex Cox's phone, right? Let's think about this. Alex Cox's phone is being moved about, but what about Lori Vallow, right? It's stated that she has always had random burner phones uh-huh. and stuff like that. She's a crazy mad woman who has all these phones and keeps switching out SIM cards, even with Charles. So yeah. Who's to say she's not the one moving the phone?
It's true. That's the thing. Lori, it has been confirmed that Lori had a series of phones, like four phones. So much, in fact, that one time when they were in Hawaii, Tylee was like, oh my gosh, mom, you look like a drug dealer. So yeah, how do we know for sure that it was Alex? Other than, I mean, I'm sure law enforcement has video at this point.
What about the neighbor's camera? That's a missing piece in a lot of this, is that, okay, we have footage of JJ, but wouldn't the camera capture a lot of their movements as well?
Well, here's another question. Apparently, people from that complex, the townhouse complex, have come forward and, like, nobody actually moves around in the courtyard at all. People go in through garages.
Oh, that makes perfect sense.
Most of the movement. Apparently, there are very, 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 very few cameras there, like as a whole, and that most people come in and out of their homes via the garage. So it is entirely plausible that Alex, whenever he would go to Lori's house, would just kind of like walk down the back and go in via her garage.
It does lead to the main street very easily, too. The garages and how they have it set up in the townhomes.
Mm-hmm.
So that makes sense. I mean, I would probably end up doing the same thing.
Yeah. I don't know. And I wonder, do you think that, I mean, it's just speculation. Again, this is speculation, but I feel like the affidavit that they're putting just important pieces, right? Yes. Not necessarily insinuating things, but the way that they mention JJ being slumped on Alex's shoulder.
Yeah.
When he comes back in the house, is it possible that he had already killed JJ at that point?
I think we should talk about that in our afterthoughts.
I agree with you.
I have a lot to say about that, actually.
I have a lot to say about the storage facility. I would like to talk about the interactions with the kids, the storage facility, why they needed it, what's going on, and other stuff. So two things, okay? We are going to, in the next week or so, do a top-to-bottom overview of the case, from ground zero, starting from the very beginning and putting all of these timelines together. So please be ready for that.
Keep your ears open.
Keep your eyes and ears open. Don't forget to check us out on social media. We would greatly appreciate that. And also our Patreon, if you are interested in getting some swag, our private Facebook group, which has been hopping.
So many questions from the beautiful people in our Patreon-only group. I see a lot of engagement. I see everyone is helping each other to understand this case, mm-hmm. if you want to be a part of that. And also, we're doing other cases and Patreon-only episodes and our afterthoughts. Mm-hmm. In our afterthoughts, we're going to be addressing quite a few things, right, Robin?
Yes. Two pieces, though, before we pivot over to our Patreon-only afterthoughts stuff. We asked, I love, guys, that we ask and we receive from
Absolutely.
You.
It's so helpful. I love the engagement. I really do. And it motivates us, right?
It does. All we have to do is say, hey, can anyone tell us X, Y, or Z? And then we literally get a flood of emails. So two things. We put out, so as you guys know, handful of family members and friends related to this case listen to the show. And so I would like to thank one person in particular. I will keep you anonymous. But she did answer the question regarding Jaci bringing up Melanie Gibb, stating that Lori had the largest one of her houses with Charles's.
And that was in the Melanie Gibb interview. Yeah. Melanie Gibb stated in the interview, well, this was one of Lori's larger homes. Mm-hmm.
So a family member of the case reached out to us, and thank you so much for your information. You have been so incredibly helpful. And she stated, as for the question about Melanie's quote about Lori's larger home, Lori, her family, or Charles have not owned a home since 2007 in Austin that was foreclosed upon. They rent, and it is my understanding that they are or were house stagers in Hawaii and Arizona. What they do is they move into a home that is for sale and pay a reduced amount of rent. So that actually makes sense, because one of the key questions that people have been talking about is why they have no effing furniture.
Yeah, that's
any home.
Odd. Yeah.
And when Charles was killed by Alex, and you see the police cam, you know, the badge cam or what, a chest cam, and the house was like empty, except for either mattresses on the floors or...
You can't make a monster more eerie in their little dungeon, can you?
Right.
Give them no furniture, because that's not a weird way to live.
But that makes sense. If they move into a home that's for sale, they don't want to, drag in all of their crap.
Exactly.
From place to place. And I'm sure that moving from Hawaii to the mainland isn't that easy of a move either. Or, you know, cheap.
No, it's not. And it's very expensive to have your stuff shipped over the ocean, more or less.
Yeah. And that would also explain Rexburg, too, about when, you know, Lori in the townhome, the babysitter noted that it was pretty much a bed and and JJ's mattress. And that was it. That does explain a great deal of why there was no furniture in, like, any of their homes.
Yeah. It's not exactly the minimalist lifestyle that I would want to live, but it's just weird.
Yeah. So thank you very much for that. We really appreciate you reaching out to us and just have an amazing amount of gratitude.
A huge amount of gratitude. Thank you.
Again, with the dowsing. So what we're going to do is we invited Ian back on to talk about how dowsing and some of Chad's stuff, now that we have a greater overview, Church of the Firstborn, dowsing, of how that relates to LDS doctrine.
I think that's going to be very insightful. Yes. And I'm actually excited to have Ian back to talk about that piece with us.
Mm-hmm. So we will be having that in the next week or so, along with an intro to the case. Guys, we are so busy.
Very busy.
So guys, thank you again for joining us. We are going to pivot over to our afterthoughts. Thank you again for listening. If you have any questions, thoughts, concerns, information, you can reach out to us at wesawthedevil@gmail.com, Twitter @wesawthedevil, Facebook @wesawthedevil, Instagram @wesawthedevilpodcast. And if you want to be a Patreon, you can find that at patreon.com/wesawthedevil.
Wait, what's our name?
We Saw the Devil. So that's it for this time, guys. Until next crime.
Until next crime.
This podcast includes graphic depictions of true crime cases and may contain explicit language. Listener discretion is advised. Thank you.